WNYC, independent journalism in the public interest. 93.9 FM and AM 820, NPR News and the New York Conversation.
This program is brought to you in part by a grant from the Corporation for Public Broadcasting.
Marketplace is supported by C3.ai. C3.ai software enables organizations to use artificial intelligence at enterprise scale, solving previously unsolvable business problems. Learn more at C3.ai.
There's a stock market story that's raising some eyebrows. We will explain. And oh yeah, we'll talk about Jay Powell too. From American Public Media, this is Marketplace.
Marketplace is supported by Cabot Creamery, a farm family cooperative since 1919, crafting traditional cheddar cheese, offering comfort recipes and educational resources at cabotcheese.coop. And by Baird, dedicated to attracting and retaining talent from across the financial industry, providing continuity for clients. More at BairdDifference.com. And by Weaver, a national CPA and advisory firm that firmly believes when you put people first, the numbers follow. Weaver, accounting for more than numbers. Learn more at Weaver.com.
In Los Angeles, I'm Kai Rizdahl. It is Wednesday today. I do believe it's the 27th of January. Good as always to have you along, everybody. We stop first today in the White House briefing room. Press Secretary Jen Psaki fielding questions at the podium.
Is the White House concerned about the stock market activity we're seeing around GameStop?
Yes, GameStop, the video game retailer slowly disappearing from shopping malls near you, whose shares have jumped 1,700% since the beginning of the year. 1,700%. It's become a thing among market watchers, obviously, but also obviously because somebody asked about it at the White House. So here's what Jen Psaki said.
Our economic team, including Secretary Yellen and others, are monitoring the situation. It's a good reminder, though, that the stock market isn't the only measure of the health of our economy.
First of all, amen on that stock market thing. Good reminder indeed. But also, what is going on here that the Treasury Secretary has to keep an eye on it? Emily Stewart covers business and politics for Vox. She has been on the GameStop story since it heated up, which was all of like a week or 10 days or so ago. Emily, welcome to the program.
Thanks for having me.
Could you give me in, say, 35, 40 seconds, the layperson's version of what exactly is going on here?
I mean, in one word, it's kind of Reddit. But basically, over the past several days, there's this forum on Reddit called Wall Street Bets. It has about 3 million people in it now, and they've gotten really excited about GameStop stock. And because of some different mechanisms in the market, as well as them just piling in, they've driven up the stock an enormous amount.
In the hundreds and hundreds of percent gains, we should say, in like a week. It's craziness. We should point out here that GameStop, the company, has 5,000 stores, mostly in malls. It's having trouble with online. There's not in and of itself a lot that's going for the company in a business sense to validate these kind of valuations.
Right. I mean, so that's one of the reasons that there is this interest in GameStop, because basically what has happened is that there are these like hedge funds can be short sellers, right? Which when you're a short seller, you think that the stock is going down.
Right.
So basically what's happened with GameStop is like people are kind of bucking that idea. And there is somewhat of a business case. Like they have a new board member, like maybe they're going to get more into e-commerce, but like nobody's going to the mall and nobody's going to the mall in the middle of a pandemic.
Right. Is all of this legal? What the folks on Reddit are doing, all these short sellers, is this market manipulation?
I think that the short answer here is that I don't know. Nobody's really sure yet. I've talked to some different people. And is this different than like a big hedge fund guy going on CNBC and being like, I think this is good or bad? Or, you know, Bill Ackman years ago deciding he was going to short Herbalife and talking about that for a long time. Like, that's allowed. So it's hard to say.
Right. Well, so let's get to that point, right? Wall Street, broadly speaking, is upset because these folks on Reddit have kind of disintermediated themselves, right? And they are taking advantage of technological tools, easier trading, the speed of information on the internet, and doing what Wall Street has been doing for decades, nigh on centuries now. And there's a little bit of, how come they can do this, right?
Yeah. I mean, you turn on like a CNBC and there's quite a bit of finger wagging going on right now. And that's been happening for quite some time. And it is sort of easy, even as just like a layperson, to be like, well, this seems irresponsible. But at the same time, like, we do live in a country where wealth creation is really hard. And so, like, how do you blame people for giving this a go, even if they are being a little bit reckless?
One more thing, and then I'll let you go. Markets are supposed to be all about efficient allocation of capital, right? And you put your capital where there's something productive happening, and that lets productive things happen, and people get hired, and they get jobs, and they can make more productive things, and then more capital gets allocated to that. That does not seem to be what's going on here.
No, but I don't think that, I think like what I was saying before, is that always how markets work?
Yeah.
I don't think that there is an argument that Wall Street is always hyper-responsible. I mean, we were in the middle of a financial crisis, what, 10, 15 years ago? That was their fault. So, you know, obviously, I think this is sort of exposing a little bit of sometimes the fallacy of why people are investing. And again, like, you can't blame some of these retail traders for playing a game that plenty of really rich people have been playing for a long time.
Totally true. This is the actual last question. Sorry. Do you suppose the regulators are going to look at this? Is the SEC going to come climbing in here and go, no, 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 you can't do that? I mean, do you think there's going to be more fallout from this?
I mean, I feel like they have to at least take a look. Like, Joe Biden's getting asked about this, right? They have to take a look. Right. I mean, what will come of that? I don't really know what the consequences are going to be here.
Somebody's going to lose their shirt, though.
Yes, I do hope at least that people are doing this, that they are, like, selling enough to break even.
Yeah, yeah, because you can lose 100%, let me tell you that. Emily Stewart covers business and politics at Fox. Emily, thanks a lot.
Thanks so much.
On Wall Street today, well, GameStop shares closed up 135% on the day, so that's normal. Not. The broader markets, also not. We'll have the details when we do the numbers. We'd be remiss if we didn't mention the Federal Reserve here real quick. Jay Powell and the gang wrapped up a two-day meeting on the health of this economy today. The TLDR, the too long didn't read, is that the virus is still in charge. No, he has not talked to Secretary Yellen since she has been confirmed, or President Biden. He would not touch with a 10-foot pole. The question of whether he is relieved the previous occupant of the White House won't be bothering him anymore. And no, he's got nothing to say about GameStop. He did, though, have some things to say about jobs, this pandemic, and doing what it takes no matter how much money is being spent on relief.
I'm much more worried about falling short of a complete recovery and losing people's careers and lives that they built because they don't get to work back to work in time and things like that. I'm more concerned about that and the damage that will do, not just to their lives, but to the United States economy, to the productive capacity of the economy. I'm more concerned about that than about the possibility, which exists, of higher inflation.
Okay, so about people who are working now, specifically the people who have to be out and about to be on the job. We know essential workers are at higher risk than the rest of us. And now we have a better idea of just which workers face the greatest risks and by how much. From the Workplace Culture Desk, Marketplace's Megan McCarty-Carino reports on some new research from the University of California, San Francisco.
The analysis shows that food workers in restaurants, food production, and agriculture face the greatest threat. Their risk of dying has gone up by 40% during the pandemic, and for Latinx workers in the sector, by 60%.
Sadly, it does not surprise me.
Jason Urashes works with a population of largely immigrant farm and poultry workers at the Legal Aid Justice Center in Virginia.
They're going to be cramped into packed buses. They're going to be living side by side, often in cramped housing, and they're going to go work side by side in the fields.
Construction, warehouse, delivery, and retail workers have also died at higher rates, says study author Kirsten Bibbins-Domingo of UC San Francisco.
These are often low-wage essential work jobs. The need to work, even if one is not feeling well, might be there. We know sometimes the job protections are not there.
Bibbins Domingo says the research shows the need to target public health measures and vaccine distribution to protect this population. The CDC had recommended that essential workers be prioritized for vaccination after healthcare workers and nursing home residents, says Drew Altman, who heads the Kaiser Family Foundation.
That made complete sense on paper, but was too complicated to be implemented by our fragmented, multi-layered health system in practice.
So more than half of states made it simpler by opening vaccination to anyone over 65, sometimes before essential workers. I'm Megan McCarty-Carino for Marketplace.
One of the themes running through the actions on this economy coming out of the White House so far is of racial justice and economic equity. It's in today's executive orders on climate change, about which more later. It was in yesterday's memos and orders on specific issues, orders covering incarceration and xenophobia, among them. It's an acknowledgement that racism is systemic in this economy, and it's an attempt to use the powers of the federal government to do something about it. Marketplace's Kimberly Adams is on that story.
President Biden has asked all the executive agencies to do some introspection to see if what the federal government is doing is reducing economic inequality or perpetuating it.
We have a number of laws that have intentionally or unintentionally excluded entire communities.
Jessica Fulton is vice president at the Joint Center for Political and Economic Studies.
And a lot of those policies are still on the books. Our agencies are still enforcing them, and we have not yet done the work to identify those policies and rectify them.
That will take some honesty about the role active racism has historically played in policy development.
One example of that is the New Deal, which created the white middle class in America.
Gary Cunningham is president and CEO of the advocacy group Prosperity Now. He says for many of the programs in the initiative,
at the time that the New Deal was created, if you were African American, you couldn't participate.
The Biden administration is placing special emphasis on reviewing housing policy through a racial equity lens, says Jesse Van Tol, who runs the National Community Reinvestment Coalition.
The legacy of, yes, the compounded effects of individual acts of racism, but are more systemic in their nature and in their cure.
He says executive actions are a first step in addressing the legacy, but points out meaningful change will need to include Congress along with everyone else.
You know, at the state and local level, it has to be confronted as part of a conversation about race in America.
What role the government has played in creating inequality and what, if anything, it should do about it. In Washington, I'm Kimberly Adams for Marketplace.
Coming up,
Frankfurt, Paris, Milan never will be the size of the City of London.
They'd really like to try, though, I'll tell you that. First, let's do the numbers. Oh, the Wawa's. Been a while, huh? Dow Industrial's down 633 points today, 2%, 30,303. The NASDAQ off 355 points, that is 2.6%, 13,270. The S&P 500 down 98, about 2.5%, 37.50 there. If you started a new pandemic garden last year, you were part of a trend. New gardeners planted everything from full vegetable patches to a couple of pots on a windowsill. Axiom Marketing found that 86% of homeowners plan to continue gardening in 2021. Scotts Miracle-Gro, thus, wilted 2.6% today. Lowe's down 3.4%. Central Garden and Pet up 1.1%. You're listening to Marketplace.
Marketplace is supported by Progressive Insurance, offering its Home Quote Explorer so shoppers can evaluate options in one place when buying home insurance. Custom quotes and rates are available online. Learn more at progressive.com. And by Indigo Ag, whose carbon program is a growing community of businesses and farmers pioneering verified agricultural climate solutions, guided by science and technology for the betterment of people and planet. IndigoAg.com/carbon support. And by NetSuite, helping businesses get control over financials, HR, inventory, e-commerce, and more. Over 24,000 companies use NetSuite by Oracle. Product tours at netsuite.com/public radio.
WNYC supporters include Showtime Documentary Films, presenting My Psychedelic Love Story. Director Errol Morris examines Joanna Harcourt Smith's romance with the high priest of LSD, Timothy Leary. Awards eligible, now streaming on Showtime.
WNYC and the New York Public Library have teamed up for a virtual book club experience. I'm Allison Stewart, host of All of It, and the book club Get Lit. This month, we've been reading the novel Mexican Gothic, and now it's time to discuss. Join me, author Silvia Moreno-Garcia, and Grammy-winning duo Rodrigo y Gabriela for a live stream book club. Tonight at 7, get directions on how to borrow the ebook from the New York Public Library and find the link to watch live at wnyc.org/getlit.
You're listening to Marketplace on WNYC. At 7 o'clock, it is Ask Governor Murphy. If you have a question for New Jersey's governor, well, submit your questions now at askgovmurphy.org and then tune in at 7 o'clock tonight on WNYC.
This is Marketplace. I'm Kai Rizdahl. Today is Climate Change Day at the Biden White House, the new administration following a more traditional media and policy rollout formula. Anyway, the president signed a series of executive orders this afternoon about steps he is taking to deal with a warming planet. And one of those orders surely got the attention of oil and gas companies, a pause on new oil and gas leasing on public lands. Marketplace's Andy Euler is on that one.
Fossil fuel leasing on federal and tribal land makes up a small percentage of onshore production, but environmentalists see President Biden's order as one way to make a dent in carbon output. Leah Stokes teaches at the University of California, Santa Barbara.
What the Biden administration is doing is saying, we're not going to do new leases, and we're going to take a comprehensive look back at the leases that we've already done to make an assessment of, you know, if these are good deals or not.
Those leases generated more than $8 billion for federal, state, local, and tribal governments last year. Big Oil sees this order as a threat to revenue and jobs. But Nick Loris at the Heritage Foundation says before that happens, the order is going to court.
Because there are well-established legal requirements, the Mineral Leasing Act, which stipulates that the Department of Interior and the Bureau of Land Management have to offer lease sales.
Biden reiterated today that fracking won't be banned, but said the government needs to help create more jobs and cleaner energy. Tom Sanzillo at the Institute for Energy Economics and Financial Analysis says Big Oil's business model is unsustainable and needs to change.
What Biden is doing is setting up what essentially will be a planning opportunity. We need some kind of new constructive action, and I think this could be it.
Today's announcement set a goal of protecting 30% of federal land and water by 2030. I'm Andy Euler for Marketplace.
Should you be in need of business and economic news early of a weekday morning? Try the Marketplace Morning Report, would you? We talked up at the top of the program today about what's going on in the stock market, GameStop specifically, and all of that. Stocks are not the only market, though, where people invest, sometimes a whole lot of money. Talking about art now, Masha Golovina is the director of acquisitions at Masterworks.io. Masha, thanks for coming on.
Thanks so much, Kai. Thank you for having me on.
Well, so let's talk about how the art market's been doing low these past, what are we now, 10 months into this thing. I mean, the recession's come to a stop. It has slowly restarted. People are still a little leery about spending money. What are you seeing in your line of work?
So I think the art market is really interesting in that it doesn't follow what you would think of as the typical progression in terms of the economics of it. And so we've seen really solid results for blue chip artworks. And I think that's not too surprising given that we do often speak about almost two economies within the greater U.S. economy or globally speaking, where stocks are at all-time highs, and meanwhile unemployment is still, you know, surging over 6%. So, you know, in the art market, things really came to a standstill in March, and then private sales took the place of auction sales, and auction sales really didn't pick up again until the end of June, beginning of July.
Right. So let's talk for a second, though, about the recovery, because I wonder, you know, much has been made, and you alluded to it a minute ago, the differential nature of this recovery, right? People on the bottom are maybe not doing so great, and people in the upper echelons of the income spectrum are doing quite fine, thank you very much. And I wonder if you're seeing the same kind of thing in the art market, right? I mean, I'm sure anybody who can afford $100 million painting can still afford $100 million painting. But if I'm a small gallery owner or a lesser known artist, it's probably a more difficult time.
We've seen smaller galleries struggle more than the mega dealers.
Yeah.
I'll just use New York as an example. A number of collectors basically moving out to their homes in the Hamptons, and then once winter rolled around, more recently you had people fly down to Palm Beach and Miami. And so what the mega dealers were able to do was to open physical spaces in the Hamptons, in Palm Beach. And, you know, we're seeing record prices. In June, the first sales back for that blue chip segment, we saw 19 records for 19 artists.
Wow.
And I think that's very impressive given that there had just been no sales since March.
Sure. Do we need, you know, the big Art Basel Miamis and all the rest of it to make the art market go? Or can you do this now virtually? I mean, there's a whole big conversation about, are we going back to the office? Are there going to be conventions? Are people going to travel for business, you know?
You don't absolutely need, you know, physical art fairs for sales to happen. I think it's a really effective way to see a lot of artworks at once and really get a sense of how the market is doing and what kind of property is coming up for sale.
Mm-hmm.
When it's coupled with online, that's the ideal mix. But I do think that returning to art fairs in some capacity, once there's a safe way to do so, is going to re-energize the market.
Yeah, I mean, I get it. You're going to plop down a bunch of money for a painting or a piece of art. You want to see it in real life, right?
Exactly.
Masha Golovina, she's the director of acquisitions at Masterworks.io. Masha, thanks a lot. I appreciate your time and your expertise.
Thank you so much, Kai.
The Center of British Finance, the city, it's called, capital T, capital C, about a square mile in the middle of London, is having some post-Brexit angst because it wasn't included in the trade deal the UK made with the European Union. And now that the UK is out of the EU, the city's ability to get to that huge market right next door has been at least partially limited. There are talks happening, of course, but in the meanwhile, as Marketplace's Stephen Beard reports from London, one city's angst is another city's opportunity.
The city lies just to the east of St. Paul's Cathedral, Britain's most famous church alongside Europe's biggest financial centre. But is Brexit going to drive the money changers out of London? Has the exodus already begun?
The best estimates now are that perhaps 10,000 jobs have been lost.
Sir Mark Boliat, a city grandee and fierce opponent of Brexit.
It means there are 10,000 fewer jobs in London than there were, and 10,000 more somewhere else in the European Union.
And this is where some of those jobs have gone.
Das sagen Sie immer wieder.
The Frankfurt stock market. The EU has decreed that all official trading in EU-listed equities must take place only on EU exchanges. Since Britain has the same financial regulations as the EU, this is a mean-spirited land grab, says Andrew Hilton of the CSFI think tank.
The Europeans want some of this business that London has. It is the major international financial centre, and the Europeans want a slice of it.
And he says the EU member states have bent over backwards to lure bankers and brokers and other finance workers away from London.
If you relocate from London to Paris, for instance, you can get a 70% break on your income tax. A similar deal in Italy, a similar deal in Spain, it's pretty cutthroat.
And no one has been quite as cutthroat as the French.
Mesdames et messieurs, chers amis, Avec cette édition spéciale des prix Choose France,
under a program called Choose France, the French government has offered London-based financial firms a wide range of inducements, streamlining its bureaucracy, for example. It's begun to pay off. Big American companies like Goldman Sachs have shifted several thousand jobs from London to the French capital. French policymakers have been quoted gloating that they are, quote, going to feed off the carcass of the city. And so what has the UK government been doing to protect London's financial centre against European predators?
The government has not prioritised financial services in the way that you would have expected.
Sir Simon Fraser, former head of the UK Foreign Office, who now runs the Flint Global consulting firm.
The voice of the city and does not appear to have been listened to as much as you would have expected.
It should have, he says. The EU accounts for a third of the city's exports. The UK government is now negotiating for the city to be granted so-called equivalent status so it can continue to trade freely with the EU. It had better succeed, says Fraser.
If there is a long-term uncertainty about the regulatory equivalence arrangements, then that could become a danger.
Brexiteers shrug off the threat. Daniel Hodgson, former head of the Life Futures Exchange, is not in the least bit alarmed by the continental scramble for the city's share of international business.
Yes, you've got good financial centres like Frankfurt, like Paris, like Milan, but they are not and never will be, certainly not in a generation, the size of the City of London.
The city job losses of 10,000 are minimal, he says, out of a total workforce of 750,000. The city is literally too big, too liquid to fail. The EU needs its vast pools of capital. The next few months should reveal whether that confidence is justified. In London, I'm Stephen Beard for Marketplace.
This final note on the way out today, a quick bookend to the GameStop story that we started with. It's not like that's the only company that's become mysteriously popular with retail investors of late. Tootsie Roll Incorporated, yes, Tootsie Roll, up 53% at one point today. AMC, the movie theater chain in a whole world of hurt, as we have been telling you about, is worth five times as much today as it was at the beginning of the pandemic. Blockbuster, which isn't even a company anymore. It's gone bankrupt. Its holding company, BB Liquidating, up 700% yesterday, up as much as 300% today. Remember, please, what Jen Psaki and some other guys says, the stock market is not the economy.
Marketplace is supported by Personal Capital, offering advice from fiduciary advisors and professional-grade financial tools. Learn more at personalcapital.com. And by Hint, fruit-infused water in over 25 flavors like watermelon, mango, and blackberry. No sweeteners, no calories. In stores or delivered from drinkhint.com.
All right, we've got to go, but here's your midweek moment of economic context. Hat tip to Bloomberg, where I saw it this morning. A nugget on global debt and this pandemic. In the past year, says the Institute of International Finance, governments and companies have added more than $19 trillion to the global balance sheet. That is $19 trillion in new debt just in the past year. Is that necessarily a bad thing? No, it's not. First of all, interest rates are basically zero, hearkening back to Jay Powell earlier. And borrowing now is better than a depression later. Our media production team is Robin Edgar, Garrett Lang, Drew Jostad, Jeff Peters, Jay Siebold, Charlton Thorpe, Ben Colliday, and Becca Weinman. They're the ones going to the studios so that the rest of us don't have to. I'm Colin Risdahl. We will see you tomorrow, everybody. This is APM.